Major support for Do the Math has been provided by Chevron, the Kern County Superintendent of Schools, California Resources Corporation, Southern California Edison, Kern Schools Federal Credit Union, Panama Buena Vista Union School District, Bakersfield City School District, and the San Luis Obispo County Office of Education, with additional production assistance provided by these supporters of education in Kern County and throughout the state of California.
Well, good afternoon and welcome to Do the Math. I'm Michael.
I'm Joost.
And I'm Chuck. Give us a call if you have some math questions, you need help with your homework, getting ready for a test, whatever. We'll answer any of your math questions. In Bakersfield, you can call us at 636-4357. San Luis Obispo and outlying areas, you can call toll-free at 1-866-636-6284. If it's easier, you can email us your questions at dothemath@kern.org. You can watch the show live online at dothemathonline.net. And we're on social media. You can see us on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and YouTube.
All right. Well, nice to have Joost in studio with us again today.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be back.
It's nice when you have come a couple of times and can return and come back. So yes, it's nice to have you back in studio again with us. We have a very special guest in studio. We'll get to that young man in a little bit. And we also have a very exciting trip that we're going to this afternoon. We'll be going live out there. It's actually pretty close to home here, yeah, as far as where the studio is. But wondrous things go on over there. So we'll check those guys out in a little bit. But before we get to all of that, let's first take a look at today's Math in the News. So, oftentimes when you see relatives, and I'm thinking back when I was younger, and you don't see relatives for a long time, and you're at the dinner table, and, well, you eat like a horse, you know, or you eat like a bird. You remember hearing one of those sayings?
Yes.
And so there was an article about that that I was reading the other day. So I decided, well, let's apply math to this.
Okay.
All right, so here we go. We have some photos of birds eating.
Mm.
And we can see that there's some pretty dramatic snapshots there.
Yes.
You know, here you've got your seed. You know, you've got like an insect there, or seed possibly, mm-hmm, but you've got some larger items there for these birds.
Protein.
But so what do you think of when someone says you eat like a bird?
I think you're eating very little.
Very little,
small
yeah,
amounts.
Just picking at it.
Yeah.
Right, which is what most people think. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we go to this one. To eat like a bird means to eat very little, but birds eat a lot. Most birds eat half their weight in food every day. That's like a 100-pound person eating 50 pounds of food in a day. And some young birds eat more than their weight in food every day. So you can see the cartoon right here. You know, you eat like a bird. Okay. And then here's another cartoon. Diane wasn't getting the results she was hoping with her new eat like a bird diet.
Okay,
so the funny with the worms and stuff like that.
Funny. Yes. That's not the word I would have used, actually.
Clever.
Disgusting, I think.
Disgusting. You've never eaten worms?
Yes, I actually have.
Well, oh, see that? I didn't know what it was going to say. And how old were you when this happened?
Oh, I was probably 10.
Oh, I thought you meant like 10 years ago.
No, I was eating a peach. And
oh, and there was a worm in it?
No, there was a half a worm in it.
Oh, good. So you got the other half. Good. All right, so that's how you do it. Okay. I was like, oh, there's a worm in it.
No worm or a whole worm wouldn't have been bad, but half a worm, that was the worst.
So I decided, all right, let's go ahead and see what math is behind this right here. Okay, so you eat like a bird. All right, a bird, a Cooper's hawk, a medium-sized bird, eats around 12% of its weight per day. So that means a human that weighs 150 pounds would eat 18 pounds of food if they ate like a Cooper's hawk.
Mm-hmm.
18 pounds of food.
It's quite a
steak.
That's
a lot.
Yeah.
Okay. A little chickadee at your feeder eats the equivalent of 35% of its weight. You know, a little tiny bird, 35%. You'd be eating 600 granola bars a day. A hummingbird, tiny little bird, right? Mm-hmm. Drinks about 100% of its body weight. You'd be drinking 17 and a half gallons of milk alongside with everything else.
That's a lot of milk.
Yeah. So that is how we could take and compare what the percent of the bird is eating compared to what a human would be eating to make the equivalent amount right there.
That's right.
And that is today's Math in the News. Quite interesting, I found that to be. 636-4357 is the phone number. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. In studio with us right now, we have Briggor. How are you?
Good.
Why don't you let everybody know where you go to school and what grade you're in?
I go to Buena Vista Elementary, and I'm in sixth grade.
Do you eat like a bird?
No.
No? Because otherwise, you'd be getting pretty big all of a sudden, right? Yeah. So if you could eat like a bird, where you would have to eat a lot of food at one time, is there a favorite food that you have that you would be like, yeah, bring it on. I'll eat it all day, all whatever you've got?
Probably teriyaki chicken.
Ooh, there you go, the teriyaki chicken. I didn't, you know what, a lot of people, hamburgers, pizza, things like that. And, you know what, I might join you on that one right there, a little teriyaki chicken. How's sixth grade going?
Good.
Now, one of the things that the Kern County Superintendent of Schools is in charge of, they run, is Camp Keep.
Yeah.
And this is perfect because you were there last week.
Yes.
So tell us some of the cool things about Camp Keep. What are some of the things you did? What are the things you liked and things like that?
At Camp Keep, I liked the different activities they had. They had a touch tank and you can hold snakes.
Okay.
Also,
and that was up where you guys stay, right?
Yeah.
Up near the dome and all that stuff?
Yeah. On the hikes, you get to hike up a giant mountain, and when you get to the top of the mountain, you get to see all over the ocean, and you get to see more rock.
Yeah, you do. Were you able to go up and try the rocks? You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
And tell everybody about that, because when I go, like, people are like, what are you doing up there?
Oh, when you try the rocks, they stick to your tongue.
Right. And that's not something that happens all over the place, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. And what did you think of the food?
It was amazing.
It was pretty good, right? I mean, you go to camp for a week and you think, oh, you know, we're just going to eat some stuff and maybe it'll be all right and hopefully palatable so we eat. But it's actually very good food over there, isn't it? Now, what about the campfires and things like that?
You get to sing a lot of campfire songs, and that's like your meeting place almost every time they sound the horn or the conch shell.
Right. And the songs, if I remember correctly, you're learning things during those songs also, right?
Yes.
Do you remember any of the songs?
The scat rap.
Yeah, there you go. See, every kid remembers that one, right? Give us a little bit of that.
It starts with an S and it ends with a T. It comes out of you and it comes out of me. I know what you're thinking, but don't call it that. Be scientific and call it scat.
Yeah, there you go. I'm digging that, man. That is the way to go right there. All right, so Camp Keep, and I'm sure that a lot of people in the building that help run that program are awfully glad to hear when you guys go over there and have a great time. So you'll remember that for many, 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 many years. But while you're here, we've got a moment or two. I want to get you over to the board, and we're going to work on some expressions.
Okay.
All right, head on over to the board with Joost, and we're going to work on one of these. All right? So first we have N,
okay,
and then open a set of parentheses. Yeah, I think your sweater might be your. So open parentheses after the N. 8 + 6 - 19. Oh. Well, leave the, there you go. So erase the parentheses.
All right, Nate.
There you go.
Yeah. -19, close parentheses, and now go ahead and simplify that. And explain to Joost what you're doing, because he's just kind of there watching what's going on. But
N, anything in the parentheses is times by N.
Okay.
So N times 8 is 8N. N times positive 6 is positive 6N. N times minus, negative 19 is negative 19N.
Yeah, maybe move your hand back a little bit on the pen.
Yeah, there you go. Good job.
Then you combine all of them. I would combine the positives and then do the negatives. So 14N, and then minus 19 n.
Okay.
So that's how you would figure that out. And since 19 is bigger, you would do a negative number. So that would be 5, negative 5 n.
All right. All right. Very good.
Looks good. Go ahead and erase that, and we'll get one that's a little bit more extended now.
Wow, you got skills. Let's see if that.
All right, so move over to your left a little more. This one's going to be a little longer.
You got good skills.
So we'll start with 6.
All right.
Open parentheses. Mm-hmm. B minus A. Close parentheses. Plus 2. Open parentheses. 4A. Minus 3B. All right, go ahead and simplify that.
6 times B is 6B. 6 times A is 6A. And then we're done with this side. Plus 2, a positive 2 times 4A is positive 8A. Positive 2 times negative 3B is negative 6B. Then what you need to combine these, and this is 0, so.
Now why is that 0?
Because positive 6, it's basically 6 minus 6, which is 0.
Mm-hmm.
And then.
Can I ask you a question on your 6A right there?
Yeah.
Can you tell me when you distributed the 6, how you came up with the 6A? And maybe tell me about the sign that goes in front of it?
Oh, negative 6A.
Oh,
negative
okay.
Negative 6A.
All right.
Okay. So negative 6A and plus 8 would be 8. Wait. 8 minus 6, which is 2. Then it would be negative, wait, positive 2A.
All right, very good.
There you
go. Nice work.
Nicely
good
done. So you've got the expressions underway. We'll get to a few more things in just a little bit. A reminder, we do have phone tutors available until 5:30 this afternoon. Every time you phone in and we do one of your math problems on air, your name is automatically entered into a drawing, and that drawing is for a 4-pack to go see the Bakersfield Condors. Right now, we'll go out on the road with Marylou.
Treat for you today. Today we are live at the Kern Regional Crime Laboratory and I have a very special guest with me. Why don't you let everybody know your name and what your position is?
Well, my name is Petra Emhoff. I'm a criminalist here with the Kern Regional Crime Laboratory.
And how long have you been here?
I've been here altogether for over 20 years.
Oh, wow. Now, what does your job entail?
I spent most of my time in the laboratory doing a solid dosage drug analysis, and I've also worked in the crime scene unit.
Now, you have a poster for us right here. Can you tell us a little bit about what's going on with the poster?
Yes, so this is typically what we would do, or the cycle that starts with solid dosage drugs or straight drugs that are submitted to the laboratory, and how it is submitted, received, and then each analyst, it's then analyzed, and everything that we analyze is logged into a computer system. And so these are typically the cycle that one of the drug analysis would complete, and then we do preliminary testing, as you can see here, what we also call color tests. They are microcrystalline tests that help identify whether or not a control substance is present and what type. And then we also have instrumental analysis, and at the end of this cycle, we have a report that we can give to the law enforcement agency.
Okay, so you start off obviously with the police station dropping off something to be checked in, correct?
That is correct.
Once it comes to you, can you show us, you have kind of some machines behind us? Can you kind of show us what they're for?
Yes, well, this here typically is our instrument room, and this instrumentation here is essentially the final step of the part of our analysis. And so we can actually identify if any and what kind of drug is present in the substance that was submitted to us.
How does math come into effect with what you do?
Well, the start out math that I start out with determining weights of the substances that are submitted, which is part of our report. So it starts out as a very simple math, but it's a lot of, some of it is addition, subtraction, and it also involves some statistical values. But here in the laboratory, we have different kinds of balances that we use. As you can see here, this is an analytical balance, and it's very sensitive to 4 digits after the decimal place. But we also have less sensitive balances to 2 digits and to 1 digit. So,
and this is it metric or is it US?
We are using the metric system. Everything report in weight is done in grams, and the metric system is an internationally accepted system for usually for weight, volume, and distances measured. So we use grams, and maybe I can, perhaps I can show you a little example of what
yes.
we do when we do the weight analysis.
Okay, now can you go ahead, coming back here, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself to everybody to let us know.
Hello, my name is David Zimmerman. I also work here at the Kern Regional Crime Lab. I am in the toxicology analysis unit. So whereas Petra analyzes solid dose drugs dropped off by the police officers, I analyze blood and urine for those same types of drugs, just in a lot smaller quantity.
Okay, and what are you working on right now?
So these are the typical results we see from an instrument. So what happens is we have a peak that the gas chromatograph gives us. And what we do is we integrate that peak, or we figure out the area underneath the curve. So that involves math, but that's high level calculus type math. That basically gives us a value, and then based off that value, we can determine what the concentration is in that individual's blood.
Okay, and then these are obviously the graphs that you're looking at. Can you kind of run over the numbers and stuff that we
yeah.
see right there?
So this is actually called a mass spectrum. So if you think about a compound, and it doesn't matter what compound it is, it's built of blocks. And so what this does, this actually takes that whole compound and fragments it into its individual blocks. So what we're saying at like this top peak at a molecular weight of 369 is that when it breaks into a piece, its first piece is 327 molecular weights. So this can tell us what the compound is built of, and that can identify the compound for us.
Wow, really interesting. Now, Petra, you have a problem for us, right?
Yes, I just wanted to show typically what we do in weighing the controlled substance.
Okay, great, let's see it.
And as I mentioned before, we have use balances with different sensitivities. So we have, for instance, one that has a four places after the decimal point. We have another balance that does 2, and then we have one with 1. And so they're typically not, they're no preference, often it's determined how big the sample is that we receive. So if we have a really small amount of sample, then we want to use the less sensitive. And if we have a weight or a substance that is really heavy, then we want to use the, we have to use the less sensitive because it just gives it a big, better surface to work with. But we can encounter a submission that where we have two of the same substance and we have to weigh both of them and add them together because sometimes we have to have enhancement weights and we have to show the combined substance how much did that weigh. So sometimes for instance, if I use this balance, the top loader balance, and I say, well, then my weight is 28.46 grams, but now I have a smaller substance or a smaller package, and now I'm going to use the less sensitive weight. So now I have a weight of 3.0046. And again, we weigh everything in grams. So this one has a unit of grams, both of them. So we usually use a calculator, but I'm gonna add these two together because they're the same type of substance. So we can use them and we just have a simple addition right here. And so we have, so this one would weigh together 31.4646 grams. But I have two different kind of sensitivity balances, so we truncate this if in our final report. So we would report 31.46 grams. Well, with each measurement or any kind of numerical value in this laboratory, we have to give an uncertainty, which is statistical value, which is measured and combined with lots of uncertainties that can be within the laboratory. And that is a more highly computed measurement. But we have an assigned uncertainty measurement for each of these balances that we use. So for this more sensitive one, we have a plus or minus 0.0007 grams for this measurement. And for this balance, we have a plus or minus 0.04 grams. So I have to add these two uncertainties because I have used two different balances. So my actual combined uncertainty for this measurement would be, where are we? 0.0004, right? So I'm sorry, but then we have 7.0400. So this would be my combined uncertainty in grams. Well, we will actually round this up to the least significant figure. So we, our uncertainty for this would then be 0.5 grams.
Now, I'm sorry, but wait, when you talk about truncated, which it, to students it's actually rounding, and so obviously that's important to understand.
Yes,
right?
It is. It's also to understand what are significant figures.
Well, thank you, Petra, so much. And David, thank you so much for showing us what you guys do here. It is so very important. And when we come back, we have some more here at the Crime Lab. Back to you, gentlemen, at the studio.
All right, thanks for that, Marylou. And I know Joost and Chuck and everybody, we were all like, yeah, that's pretty interesting stuff, and bringing up the significant values and things like that. So more will be coming from across the street in just a few moments. So we have a phone call right now from a seventh grade student. I want you to think about what they're doing. Okay. And I want to see if you can do it in your head, or at least if you would know how to set it up.
Okay.
You ready?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to go to the phones right now. A student from Rosedale Middle School. Sadie, how are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm wonderful myself. As soon as you're ready, let's hear that math problem that you're working on.
Okay, I am working on, I'm writing and solving a proportion, and the problem is 7/8 is 70% of what number?
7/8, the fraction?
Yes.
Is 70% of what number? Is that
yes.
it? Okay. Okay, so you said you're setting this up as a proportion, so how would you set up this problem?
I would set it up as
proportion is going to look like this,
over
right?
W, A over W, because A is part of the whole number, and then W would be on the bottom.
So W is what we're looking for?
Okay. We're looking for of what number.
Right. So we're going to call that W. You said that's going to go on the bottom?
Yes.
And what's going to go on top?
7/8.
7/8, so we're going to put that fraction inside of a fraction like this?
Yes.
Okay.
And
so that's the that's this number, right? So
yeah.
have you done is over of and percent over 100? Is that how you set up your proportion?
Yes.
Okay. So what's going to go over here?
On top of that would be a P for the percent. And then on bottom would be over 100.
So 100 is our total percent. And what percent do we have?
70%.
So does that look like the proportion that we're going to work on?
Yes.
7/8 over W equals 70 over 100. So you've got a complex fraction here, right? You've got a fraction in a fraction. But you can still do it, can't you?
Yeah.
Because now how do you solve this problem? How do you solve a proportion?
You would cross-multiply.
Okay, so when we cross-multiply, I got to take this whole number here times that entire number there, and this number times that number, right? So what
yes.
happens when we cross-multiply?
You would cross-multiply 7/8 times 100.
So let's write that down. 7/8 times 100 equals, and what's the other cross-multiplying?
W times 70.
Which is?
70W.
All right. So we're trying to solve for W. We're trying to find that missing number. What number? All right. So what do we have to do to this equation to solve it?
We have to
You have a few choices here, don't you? What's the first thing you'd want to do?
You would want to multiply.
Okay, what would you multiply, and why would you be multiplying? What would you multiply?
You would multiply 7/8 times 100.
Okay, so we're going to multiply this fraction times 100. So how do you multiply a fraction times a whole number?
You would put the whole number over 1.
You actually made it a fraction, didn't you?
Yeah.
Right? So we have 7/8 times 100 over 1, which is?
700 over 8.
Equals 70W, right?
Yes.
All right. Now, if you don't mind, we can leave that fraction as 700 over 8, right? And how would you solve for W?
You would divide.
Divide. We would divide by what?
You'll have to get W by itself, so you would divide each side by 70.
Because you want to cancel out that 70.
Yes.
Now over here, as much as it's going to look like this, right, 7/8 over W, I'd like to try whenever possible to avoid a fraction over a fraction. It just kind of makes it complicated. So if I wanted to divide by 70 on the other side, how do you divide by 70? What do you have to multiply by to divide by 70? How's that for a question? Notice where the 70 is on this side?
Yeah. And let's so you would
put the 70 in the same place on this side. And what goes on top?
70.
70 on the bottom, but 1 on the top, right?
Yeah.
So dividing by 70 is the same as multiplying by the fraction 1 over 70. And you notice that 70 and 1 over 70 are reciprocals, aren't they?
Yeah.
So we just multiply by the reciprocal. Now that makes it nice because here we got W, don't we? We've got W all by itself, which is what you wanted. Now, what are you going to do with this part of it? What's 1 over 70 times 700 over 8? Now, I could just multiply the top and multiply the bottom, couldn't I?
Yeah.
But what can you do to this fraction before you actually multiply?
You could simplify it down.
Yeah. What stands out is 70 here and 700 here, right? 70 goes into 70 how many times?
One time.
And 70 goes into 700 how many times?
10 times.
10 times. That was really nice, right? That 70 and 700 canceled out very nice. So the only thing we have left on this side is 10 on top and 8 on the bottom. Now, how do you want your answer? Do you want your answer as a fraction or as a decimal? Or maybe a mixed number?
Yeah.
So what can we do with 10 eighths?
You could
reduce, simplify.
Yeah, reduce it.
What are we going to do?
You can simplify it.
Okay, so let's simplify. What's 10 eighths?
You can divide both of them by 2.
Okay, so we're going to reduce, divide by 2. 10 divided by 2 is 5. 8 divided by 2 is?
4.
So sometimes 5/4 could be your answer, right?
Yeah.
But how else could you write 5/4?
As a mixed number.
As a mixed number. So 5 divided by 4, right?
Yeah.
4 goes in 5 once, with what left over?
1.
What's your fraction?
1 and 1/4.
That's another answer. And can you change 1/4 to a decimal pretty easily?
Yeah.
What's 1/4 as a decimal?
0.25.
So it looks like, depending on the problem, right, you might have an answer of 5/4, which sometimes is acceptable. You might have 1 1/4, and you might have 1.25. Any one of those could be your answer depending on what the problem is. Okay? Thanks for the call.
Okay.
Nicely done. And Sadie, if you're still online, because you had to find 3 different ways to represent that answer, we're going to send you home with a meal courtesy of our friends at Chick-fil-A. So congratulations on that. Hey, we do have phone tutors available until 5:30. Don't forget, if you call from San Luis Obispo County and we do your problem on air, you'll automatically receive ice cream courtesy of Doc Bernstein's Ice Cream Lab. We'll be back with more right after this. Back at Kern School's Federal Credit Union, we've got Nora and Anish with us once again. And helping us out today, we've got Kiana. How are you today?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm wonderful.
Good.
Now, the students have opened an account at Kern School's Federal Credit Union. Mm-hmm. They've got a savings account.
Great.
And last time we learned a little bit about simple and compound interest. Once people start gathering a lot of money, what do they like to do with it?
Take it out.
They like to take it out and they go spend it, right? Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to learn a little bit about debit cards and how you can use one of those.
Since you guys have the savings with Kern Schools, we can get you a debit card, because I know you guys like to go shopping, correct? Okay, so I'll issue you guys debit cards. This is for you, and this one is for you.
Thank you.
And then I'll show you how to use them. With the debit card, you can use it as credit or debit. And with credit, that just means you're gonna sign for the purchase, and it's gonna take a few days to come out your account. And with debit, it's gonna come out immediately and you're gonna put in a PIN number, okay? So I'm gonna show you guys how you can use it, so when you're out shopping, you'll know exactly what to do.
Okay. Remember, like they do, like when you buy like from Costco or Sam's Club?
Yes, exactly. They're going to give you a four-digit PIN. It's going to be a four-digit PIN that only you guys know. So I don't want you to tell your friends or anyone else because it's secret, okay?
Okay.
Great. So let's try it. We'll start with you first, okay? I'm going to slide your card over here. Okay, and do you want debit or credit?
Debit.
Debit. Okay, go ahead and enter your PIN.
Here?
Mm-hmm. And hit the green button for enter. Perfect. And there's gonna be your copy. So with the debit, you won't have to sign. You're just gonna get your receipt because you entered in your PIN, okay? And I'll hand your card
back. Thank
you. Okay, and let's do a purchase with you. Can I see your card?
Okay, here you go.
Thank you. And do you wanna do credit or debit?
Credit.
Credit. Okay. And then unlike debit, yours is going to take a few days to come out, and then you're going to sign for your purchase. And also, the merchants are going to ask you for your ID, because with your four-digit PIN, it's only for you. But with credit, anyone can use your card, so they want to verify ID to make sure that this card belongs to you. And let's say you'll spend $23. Okay, and you're not going to put your PIN number in. I'm going to actually have you sign for your copy. And you're going to sign your first and last name. Perfect. And then I would keep this, and then I'll give you a copy and your card back for your purchase.
Thanks.
Okay?
And that's one thing that the students will want to do is as they're accumulating all of these receipts, to make sure that you hold on to the receipt so that when you receive your statement via email from the credit union, you'll be able to match up your receipts with the statement to make sure that everything is coming out balanced and what you thought it was going to be. Any questions about the debit cards?
So it shows the amount of money that you took out and that you have in there now on here?
On your receipt, it's only going to show you exactly what you spent. At the store, they don't know how much money you have, so it's very important that you know what you have in your account when you're spending the money.
Okay. And the other important item is to make sure that you remember your four-digit PIN number, but not to let anybody else know that PIN number. Maybe your parents or something like that, but it's not something that you want to just go ahead and let everybody know about your PIN number.
Right.
That's why it's called personal identification number.
Exactly.
All right. Well, Kiana, thank you very much for that.
No problem. You guys have a great day.
Thank you.
On the check register, you're going to put the balance that you have in the account. And then every time you make a purchase, you're going to write down what you spent and where you spent it.
Yeah, that's funny because you said, hey, you see that money? I finally saw the money right there. And you're like, yeah, that's how we get paid. Yeah, kind of is. A few more zeros on there.
Right? Yeah, there you go.
Hey, you know what? We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. But once again, we're going to head across the street to the crime lab with Marylou.
We are back live at the Kern Regional Crime Laboratory, and we just came from Petra and David, and I have another special guest. Why don't you let everybody know your name and your position?
My name is Garrett Sugimoto. I'm the DNA technical lead criminalist over the DNA analysis unit.
Okay, Petra and David both, they talked about how a sample is brought in, a drug sample, and how they had to test that and then test the blood. What exactly is it that you do here?
So typically DNA samples are submitted and we'll receive two types of DNA evidence, one from questioned items, which are typically those from crime scenes, and we'll also get samples from known individuals. And what we do is we develop DNA profiles from both of those and say if the individual is a potential contributor to that DNA left at a crime scene.
What is DNA?
DNA, it stands for deoxyribonucleic acid, and you can think of it like a molecular code. So half of your DNA will be inherited from your mother, and half of your DNA will be inherited from your father. And so what's useful for identification purposes is that DNA is unique to every individual with the exception of identical twins.
Now, what room are we in right now?
So right now we're in the DNA analysis laboratory. This is typically where we do our extraction, quantitation, and amplification setup. And we have another room that we'll take those samples into and place them onto the actual instruments for processing.
Can you kind of give us a quick tour? Because there's some really interesting machines
Sure.
in here. What is in front of us?
So right here we just have what's called a bio hood. And this hood is actually used to where we do a lot of pipetting. And so pipetting is just where we're moving around very small volumes of liquid into different tubes. So it's used to set up different processes in the DNA analysis process.
Okay, and what's going on over here?
So this guy over here is our, it's called the MVAC system. And so what you can think of it as is basically it's a shop vac to vacuum up DNA from different items. And so typically we use it for example, for clothing items to try to get as much DNA as possible off of those items.
And what else do we have here? So obviously—
Well, we have a lot of different, we have centrifuges, we have different heat blocks in here. Some of those heat blocks actually will heat and shake the sample at the same time, so that's used in our extraction process for DNA. And then we also have an instrument in here that it's our Hamilton Starlet, and it's used to do the majority of robotic pipetting. So I mentioned pipetting manually before where we're moving liquids around by hand. This robot here can set up a plate of 96 samples basically in less than 10 minutes. So it can move around liquid by picking up pipette tips 8 at a time and moving the liquid around there.
Can you give us a little example of something that you would be working on?
Yeah, so just for example, maybe there is a can or a drinking container left at a crime scene. So what we'll do is we'll get a swab of that drinking container and we will test that and compare it to potential suspects, or we will upload that profile to a database that can search and we can potentially identify who was drinking out of that can or bottle.
So you have some examples for us, right?
Over yes. Here. So this tube right here, let's start here. This is typically our goal. So we're looking, this is a DNA profile that we would use to compare to known reference DNA profiles. And so as you can see, we have different numbers here. So like the 13 and 14 at one location, that is the DNA information at one location. And we do this for all 16 locations. And those are the points of information that are used for the comparisons. And so we have basically going through the process, we will take it through, to start out with, we'll take it through an extraction, quantitation, and amplification process. And so initially we have approximately 50 microliters of DNA, and it's the DNA would be in this very small amount of liquid, as you can see here. It's a very small tube and there's a very small amount of liquid in there. So that's typically where we'll start out. And the second step is we'll go into quantitation or quantification. And so what that instrument does is it tells us how much and what concentration approximately is the DNA in this very small amount of liquid. So for example, we may get a result that says this tube has 10 picograms of per microliter of DNA. So oftentimes we'll get such low amounts of DNA or low level samples that we'll have to optimize how much DNA we take on to the next processes. And so our goal here is to try to keep that same amount of DNA, but move it from 50 microliters of liquid down to 10 microliters of liquid. Okay, so basically we use math every day in trying to figure out if we move it from 50 microliters to 10 microliters, what will the new concentration be? And so we'll just multiply the 50 by 10 picograms over 1 microliter and then divide by 10. So basically you're moving from a 10 picogram per microliter sample to a 50 picogram per microliter sample.
Now you say picogram, which is way, because students are used to like the milligrams,
right?
But picograms is?
Picogram would be 1/1,000,000th of a gram.
Wow, yeah. Wow, so. For them to even consider that, something that we'd have to look underneath a, maybe a microscope?
Yeah, it's at the molecular level, it's a very small amount of DNA that we're working with.
Wow, it's pretty amazing what you do here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And so when we come back, we have more from the crime lab. So back to you gentlemen at the studio.
All right, we'll get back to you guys in just a couple of moments. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. Don't forget, if you'd like to email us a question, you can do that at dothemath@kern.org. Hopefully you're able to do that maybe on a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, so that we can reply to you on a Tuesday, Wednesday. If you send it in Thursday, that's kind of, I mean, you'll get a reply, but you won't get a reply until Tuesday the following week. So, Briggor, are you ready to work?
Yes.
All right, we're going to go from expressions to equations.
Okay.
All right, so head on over to the board, and we've got two more of your homework problems that we're going to work on. So let's start off with 3. Open parentheses, n plus 5, close parentheses, is equal to 23. And once again, if you would be so kind as to explain to Joost how you're solving this problem.
Okay. So 3 times n is 3n. 3 times 5, well, positive 5, is positive 15, equals 23. So first thing, I want the n over here because the number is over here. So minus 15 gets that out. And then I have to do minus 15 over here. So so 8 equals 3n. So I divide 3. Now let me reset. I divide 3n. By 3, that gives me just n. Then I have to.
That's all right. You got it. There you go. Good job.
Dang it. Okay. So divided by 3, 8 goes into 3 2 times. And then. So 8. 3. Wait.
Right. You have to switch that around a little bit there. So you're going to go 8 divided by 3. There you go.
Yeah. It's 6. Then 2. Then you have to put...
Well, instead of going decimal, just leave it as a mixed number.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Because you had an improper fraction with 8/3.
Yeah.
Which would be satisfactory.
Yeah.
So just go ahead and put it into a mixed number, the 8/3.
Okay. So it would be 2 1/3.
2 1/3 or 2 2/3? What do you think? How'd you?
Oh, 2/3.
2/3. Very good. So how? Why is it 2/3 instead of 1/3?
Because it can go into it 2 times, and the denominator is 3.
Okay. And then there's the 2 that remains, which makes it 2/3.
Mm-hmm.
All right. There you go.
All right. So that way I know that you've done some other equations where you've seen that you can have n be a positive number. You know that it could be a negative number.
Yes.
You know that it could be 0.
Yeah.
You know that there are ones with no solutions. Yes. And now you see there can be ones that are fractions.
Yes.
All right. So go ahead, erase the board.
Thank you. You could try that one right there. Whoop, there we go. Good job.
All right, here we go. This one a little bit longer, so move over to your left a little more.
Okay, yeah.
Five minus, open parentheses, n minus four, close parentheses, is equal to three, open parentheses, n plus two.
Okay, so I dropped the five, and this is a one, so it would be negative n, and then positive four, because a negative times a negative is a positive, and then equals three times n is three n, and then three times positive two is six. So I could choose which side I want the N. I'm gonna want the N on this side. Yeah, so I'm gonna combine these, which makes it nine, and then negative N.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Is right here you have three N and a six. Is that,
yeah.
Is there an operation you wanna put in there between the three N and the six?
Positive.
Okay. How about over here on the left side? Is there an operation you want to put between the negative n and the four? Or is that a nine?
That's a nine.
That's a nine. Okay, got it. All right.
Yeah.
Very good.
There. So, this I can do plus n to get rid of it, then plus n here to make this four n. Then minus six, and then it's three equals four n. Divide by four, could you scroll this?
Sure, I could scroll it.
Yeah.
Help you out right there. How's that?
Good. Equals one n. Then 3 divided by 4 would be a fraction. It would be this, or 3. 3 can go in the 4 one time.
Okay, let's talk about that. So you have 3 divided by 4, right?
Yeah.
So, if it's 3 divided by 4, is it going to be bigger than 1 or less than 1?
It would be bigger than 1.
Bigger than 1. So if, let me ask you this question. So 3 divided by 4, is that closer to 75 cents or $1.25? What do you think? That fraction.
75 cents.
75 cents. So do you think that's the way you'd want to set it up? No.
No.
Do you think you're okay just landing your problem right here that n is equal to 3/4?
Oh. I don't know.
You know? Okay, so your answer right here, you have n. On this side of the equation, you have 3/4.
Oh.
Right? So you want to just write 3/4?
Sure.
Okay. So, are you good with that answer? Do you like that answer?
Yes.
All right, very confidently.
Yeah.
A very confident yes there.
There you go. And I think instead of putting the division sign like you have like that, the division symbol, mm-hmm. if you just draw the fraction bar, you'll see automatically that it becomes 3/4 instead of trying to go 3 divided by 4 and then coming up and having to make more work for yourself where you'll understand that you see that it is. Because you said it's 3 divided by 4.
Mm-hmm. And that's not a trick question, but that's a good question. What is 3 divided by 4? It's 3 divided by 4. It's just 3/4, isn't it?
Okay.
Yeah, so no work involved.
Since you're right at the board,
let's
do 3 divided by 4 and see what it comes out to be, since you already started that process. Because you know it's going to be less than 1.
Wait, which way is it?
Okay.
That's why I want you doing this, so you do it again.
3 divided by 4.
3 divided by 4. Okay. There you go.
4 can't go into 3. So I'd put a decimal. Wait. I'd put a decimal to add zeros. Because 4 can go into 30. And then this
one. So how many times does 4 go into 3?
Zero.
Right. So how about let's start with the 0 over the 3. That's why we have 0 point when we do decimals. So over the 3, that's what you're going to start with, right?
Okay.
That was your first question, wasn't it?
Yes.
There you go.
Then 7, 28, and you subtract. And that comes out to be 2. And 4 can't go into 2. So you add a 0 here, and it drops down. 4 can go into 25. And you're done.
And so everybody knows that 3/4 is 75 cents.
Yes.
3/4 is 0.75.
Good job.
Good. Yeah. All right. Nicely done.
The wizard. The wizard. Good job.
All right. Do you know how long the show is going until today? When people can call in until? How late can people call into today?
5:30.
There you go. The phone numbers are at the bottom of your screen. But we're going to head one more time over to the Crime Lab with Marylou.
We are back live at the Kern Regional Crime Laboratory, and we just left Garrett at DNA, and now we are moving on, and I'm with Chris. Chris, can you let everybody know what your title is here?
Yes, I'm a criminalist. I've worked here for about 10 years, and I work in the firearm and tool mark section of the laboratory.
Now, with firearms, we're talking, obviously, weapons, bullets, and all that wonderful.
Correct. We do a lot of identifications. We receive firearms as well as fired components, such as bullets and cartridge cases, and we intercompare them and try to figure out which components came from which firearm.
Talking about bullets, because a lot of students obviously might not have seen bullets. We have right here, you have a chart here, correct?
Yes.
And so bullets don't all come in the same size, do they?
They do not. What you're looking at there is a variety of different diameters and weights of bullets. The diameter of those bullets is referred to as the caliber, and so we have many different types of calibers that we work with.
So if guns look similar, bullets look similar, how can you compare to find out where that shot came from, what gun it came from?
That's a great question. Right over here to my left is what we use to figure that out. This is a comparison microscope. And so what we do with these bullets is we zoom in very close into the bullet, and we look for very small microscopic marks that are left behind on the bullet from the firearm. And then we're able to compare those marks to each other.
So it's almost like different fingerprints, right?
Correct. It's very similar to a fingerprint. We can actually uniquely identify which bullet was fired by a particular firearm.
Can you kind of explain all this right here?
What we have here, what you're looking at, is a comparative microscope, and under that microscope we have 2 different cartridge cases that were fired by the same firearm. Those cartridge cases are up on that screen right over there, and we're zoomed in now on those microscopic scratches, and you can see that they all line up.
So the split screen are the 2 separate bullets, correct?
The one on the left and the one on the right are shown on that split screen.
Wow, and then it shows how they come together.
Correct.
So that's how you can determine that, yes, both of those guns were shot from the same, both of the bullets were shot from the same gun.
That is correct, yes.
Wow. You don't have it happen to have an example of 2 separate, do you?
Well, not at the moment on hand, but I can zoom out a little bit so you can see what you're actually looking at. Maybe that would help a little bit better. So what I'm doing is I'm zooming out, and you can see the full cartridge case.
Uh-huh.
So that's the whole cartridge case. This is one on the left, and that one's on the right. And then what we're doing is we're zooming in to that very specific area on the cartridge case so you can get a perspective of what we're looking at and how far we're zoomed in.
And all these grooves, are those caused from the inside of the gun?
Yes, that is where the gun scraped up against the back of the cartridge case, and it leaves, those scrape marks are very unique to each firearm. And so when they all line up consecutively like that, then we know that we have a cartridge case that was fired by the same firearm.
Wow, this is so interesting to see it in real life, because, you know, I've seen it on TV, those CSI shows, they show it, but
to actually see it in real life is amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chris, for showing us this. And now we have Allison Kennedy. Allison, why don't you let everybody know what your position is here?
Hi, I'm Allison Kennedy. I'm a supervising criminalist with the laboratory, and I supervise both the firearms unit and the drug testing units.
And how long have you been here?
I've worked at the laboratory now about 18 years.
Wow. What if students are interested in coming into this field? What course would they need to take?
As you might imagine, we are very heavy in the science fields. All of our examiners have at least their four-year bachelor's degree in a science. We have several who have their master's, and we also have a few doctorates.
So where could they start in high school?
High school, you'll be taking your basic biology, chemistry, and physics courses. If you are very interested in the sciences, by all means pursue the advanced placement courses as well.
So once in college, is there any internship that students can do?
Yes, we do have an internship program. If a student is currently enrolled in college, they can apply to be an intern here at the laboratory. They do have to pass through a background check before being placed into the laboratory.
Well, Allison, I want to thank you and everybody here. We have a little token for you.
Thank you.
Here at the lab for allowing us to come today and see actually what you do. It's so different in person than seeing something on TV, and it's really amazing what you do, and thank you again.
Well, thank you. It's been a pleasure.
All right, gentlemen, back to you at the studio.
All right, thank you, Marylou. Thank you, Allison, and everybody else over at the Kern Regional Crime Lab for allowing us to come in and check out what they do. Pretty fascinating things over there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Absolutely.
And something that you're not able to see on a regular basis, or sometimes even, I mean, it's like, what goes on in there?
Right.
So we were able to see all the background. And
to think of all of the different, I mean, you say, you know, math and science. I mean, all of the different sciences mm-hmm. that they have to use, you know, physics and chemistry and biology and everything.
And it's nice how they showed how much math actually goes into. And 1/1,000,000,000th of a gram.
Yes.
Right? That's your picogram. All right, Briggor, you are now an ambassador for Do the Math. Do you understand what that means?
Partially.
What do you think it means?
I'm part of Do the Math.
Yeah, you are part of Do the Math. You're part of the family now, so that means you need to let everybody else know about Do the Math. Can you do that?
Yeah.
Maybe not every single person you see, but every once in a while, let people know about the program, all right? So all they have to do is they can look and you're like, hey, what's going on with that? And you can just tell them, hey, it's a math program. You can call and get some math help, right? Did you have a good time today?
Yes.
All right, so I see that we got a lot of your homework done.
Yeah.
And one more thing, what's one more memory about Camp Keep that you would like to share with everybody? So you told us about the hikes and things that you had.
Yeah.
What was the best food they had?
Oh, they had a pizza night, and you could have seconds for dinner.
What?
No way.
So people would eat pizza, and they had a brownie dessert with it. And green beans.
All right. Well, a nice meal right there. One of the meals for kids.
That's right.
Hey, until we meet again, continue to do the math.
Major support for Do the Math has been provided by Chevron, the Kern County Superintendent of Schools, California Resources Corporation, Southern California Edison, Kern Schools Federal Credit Union, Panama Buena Vista Union School District, Bakersfield City School District, and the San Luis Obispo County Office of Education. With additional production assistance provided by these supporters of education in Kern County and throughout the state of California.